Recorded Books presents a Griot audio production of Do You Take This Woman? By R.M. Johnson. This unabridged recording is narrated by J.D. Jackson. This book is copyrighted 2006 by R. Marcus Johnson. This recording is copyrighted 2008 by Recorded Books, producer and publisher of Griot Audio, celebrating the best in contemporary African-American fiction and nonfiction. Pete and Wayne grew up side by side. After Pete's mother abandoned him, Wayne's family took him in, and they treated him as one of their own. Through adolescence, college, medical school, and in their shared orthopedics practice, Pete and Wayne have lived their entire lives as best friends and as brothers. And yet, as brothers, they have always been rivals when it came to women. And now, Do You Take This Woman?
Chapter 1. Last night, after walking into her house from work, Carla Barnes found her husband Pete bent over in a chair, his face buried in his hands. She stood in the doorway, afraid to go in. She was worried that he might have found out some way. She ventured in, stepped beside him, placed a hand on his shoulder. "Pete," she said, her voice soft. He did not look up, did not take his face from his hands. "Pete," Carla said again, shaking him a little. "Are you okay?" Pete raised his face. He looked anguished. Carla's heart started to beat faster, something inside telling herself that he did know. "Just tell me what's going on," Pete said.
"With what?"
"With us."
"What are you talking about?"
Carla said, feigning ignorance. She knew he was referring to Carla walking in late every evening, sometimes after 9 p.m., when she got off work at 4:30 p.m. He was talking about the distance that had been between them, her reluctance to talk to him, show him affection, touch him, make love to him.
"I don't know what you're talking about," Carla repeated, turning away.
Her husband got out of his chair and stood there behind her. "Is it someone else?" he asked. "I don't believe you do that to me, but I have to ask you. Is it?" Carla breathed a short sigh of relief. He really did not know. He was guessing, and although he was close to the truth, he wasn't certain of anything.
"No," Carla said, turning to him. "I'm not seeing anyone else. It's work, like I told you. Things have been just a little crazy, that's all."
She was lying. She wasn't seeing anyone in the way that Pete was thinking. She wasn't sleeping with another man, wasn't meeting in hotel rooms, wasn't supplementing the sex life she and her husband shared, although there was someone that she had been talking to. He was an ex-friend, an ex-lover, an ex-fiancé. When Wayne had pulled Carla aside 2 months ago at a barbecue her husband was throwing and whispered to her that he wanted to see her again, Carla could not deny that she was interested, but that was as far as she wanted it to go. She knew that she could not be alone with Wayne because of how much she had loved him those 2 years ago and how much she feared that she might still feel for him.
"I can't do that,"
Carla had said to him then, pouring herself some punch, staring directly at her husband standing across the lawn. He was smiling back at her as he grilled hot dogs and hamburgers for the 20 or so people that stood about the yard.
"I'm not asking you to cheat on him," Wayne said. "I just want to see you, talk to you, spend time with you. I miss you. It'll be innocent, I promise."
Carla turned to look at Wayne, and she knew that it could not be that. The man was beautiful. His chiseled facial features, square jaw, bread crust complexion, and that dimpled smile always made her just want to lean over and kiss him. She felt that urge then, but she suppressed it when her husband smiled again and waved at her. Carla smiled and waved back, blew a kiss at him. Wayne waved as well.
You do that to him? Your best friend? Carla asked.
I wouldn't be doing anything. I would be just talking to you, like I said. That wouldn't be nearly as bad as what he did to me.
So that's what this is. Get back for what Pete did, Carla said, sipping some of her punch, keeping an eye on her husband, making sure he did not suspect anything. You brought that on yourself.
I don't want to talk about that,
Wayne said.
I bet you don't.
Will you see me?
No,
Carla said.
I'm not accepting that answer. We'll talk some more later,
Wayne said, walking away from Carla, through the thin crowd of people and over to Carla's husband. He said something to Pete to get him laughing, slapped the man on the back, then took over the cooking duties. He did not once look back up at Carla, but like he said, she knew he did not accept her answer. After that, he called Carla at work every morning, sent her flowers, candy, cards. He would meet her outside her office building, his car running, telling her he just wanted to share a meal with her. Although some mornings she would talk to him on the phone, she would always turn him down for those meals. And then he started meeting her after work. She told him how dangerous his actions were.
What if Pete rolls up right now, sees us out here?
Then get in. We'll drive somewhere, and he won't see us, Wayne said after 2 weeks of chasing her.
That was the beginning. The first time they sat and had a drink, listened to music, talked. They had a wonderful time. Carla could not help but think about how things had been with Wayne back when they were together, when they were planning their marriage, how the rest of their lives would have been together. After the third consecutive after-work outing with Wayne, it seemed she fell right back into a groove with him. She felt so comfortable, and after returning home that night, thoughts started entering her head. They were terrible thoughts, damaging thoughts that had her locked in the bathroom long after her shower was over, hesitant about stepping out, crawling in bed with her husband. These were thoughts that had her rolling on her side, away from Pete, telling him that she wasn't in the mood, had a lot on her mind, that she just needed to sleep. After spending those few short days with Wayne, Carla was asking herself every day upon waking, had she married the wrong man? Had she been too hasty in her decision to marry Pete? She needed to stop seeing Wayne. She told herself over and over again that the last phone call would be the final one. The last outing would be the last time she would see him without Pete being somewhere nearby.
But we aren't doing anything,
Carla rationalized to her best friend Lacey King, an assistant editor who had the office next to hers.
All we do is talk.
But the talk is driving a wedge between you and your husband. Carla, he's going to find out one day. Regardless of how clever we women like to think we are, men aren't stupid. This will catch up to you.
And as Carla stood in the den with her husband last night, she realized Lacey might be right.
I'm afraid, Pete had said, that if this distance between us continues too much longer, it'll be the end of our marriage.
What are you talking about, Pete? It's a rough patch at work.
It's not just that, Pete said, raising his voice, standing up and grabbing her by the shoulders. I know there's something else.
What can I do?
We'll be fine,
Carla said, stepping away from the hold Pete had on her. She turned and walked out of the room, not answering the question, because she knew there was nothing he could do. Only she could change things. That was why the next evening, before Carla left work, she had called Wayne, asked him to meet her at Calypso, a Jamaican restaurant in Hyde Park. The entire drive there, Carla asked herself whether she was doing the right thing. Did she really want to stop seeing Wayne? After parking the car, walking in the restaurant, and ordering a drink, she told herself she had no choice. She sat there for 20 minutes. She had drunk an apple martini and was working on a second. When she saw Wayne walk in the front door, she finished the second martini. He was wearing tan linen pants and a matching jacket that had his broad shoulders filled out nicely. Carla stood up from the table, wobbled just a little on her heels. Wayne caught her by the waist.
"One too many," he said, kissing her beside her ear.
"No, I'm okay," Carla said, hugging him for a brief moment, then sitting back down.
"I've missed you,"
Wayne said, sliding over one of the menus that sat on the table in front of him.
"Are you hungry?"
"I'm not here to eat tonight," Carla said, already starting to feel sadness.
"Then what? You just want to do drinks? I can do that."
"No, Wayne. I'm here to tell you that we can't see each other anymore."
Wayne looked across at Carla, smiled uncomfortably, then said,
"You're joking, right?"
"No."
"But we aren't seeing each other. We meet to talk, hang out. What's wrong with that?"
"Everything,"
Carla said, reaching across the table, taking Wayne's hands in hers.
"These 2 months have been wonderful, but I can't continue this. I have these feelings for you. I think of you all the time, at work, at home. I'm neglecting my husband because of them. I'm sure while you two were at work, Pete told you that things aren't right between us."
"He's told me," Wayne said. "But he said that you told him things are hectic at the magazine."
"You know that's not the truth. You know it's you, Wayne."
Wayne looked up at her.
"You don't miss what we've had."
"I do. But now I have something else. I'm married now. I have to respect that, and you should too. He's your best friend."
Wayne lowered his head as though he felt shame.
"I know. I shouldn't be doing this. I don't want to ruin things between you and Pete. I missed you. I just wanted to spend some time with you."
"And what did you think would become of that?"
He peered up at her.
"Maybe that you would realize that you still had feelings for me. Realize that you married Pete because I cheated on you. And come back to me."
"No, Wayne. I left you because you cheated on me. And then I married Pete because I fell in love with him."
Wayne looked away to avoid Carla's eyes. She knew he was crushed. She saw it, regardless of how hard he was trying to hide it.
"Fine,"
he said, rising quickly from the table and moving to leave. Carla took his wrist, held him there. She stood up right in front of him, looking up into his eyes. Tears rested on the rims of his lower lids, waiting to fall.
"I'm sorry this had to happen,"
Carla said, wrapping her arms around him, hugging him tight right there in the middle of the restaurant. He let himself be comforted for a moment, then quickly pulled away from Carla and hurried out. Chapter 2. The dinner that Pete made for his wife sat on the dining room table, cold. He sat behind it, staring at a clock on the wall, watching as time slipped by. With each second, Carla became increasingly late. Pete had to ask himself whether she even cared. If he were to judge by the last 2 months, He knew the answer to that question would be no. He picked up his cell phone, punched in her number for the fifth time this evening, and was not surprised to hear her voicemail answer his call yet again. He opened his mouth to speak, but not a word came out. He was sick of it all. He flipped the phone closed, pushed back from the table, picked up the casserole dish, went to the kitchen, and emptied the casserole into the trash. He had no certain idea of what was going on, but it was bad, and with each day that went by, it had only gotten worse.
"How can I make this up to you?"
she said one night a week ago, smiling slyly and kissing his earlobe. Pete was happy, for they hadn't had sex in more than 3 weeks. They ended up in bed, made love, and afterward Pete lay on his back, Carla on her side. He was unfulfilled. Sex had lasted all of 5 minutes. Her goal seeming to be to get him there, make him come, get things over with.
"Come on, baby. Come on," she had urged him. "I don't want to. Not yet,"
he cried. But her thighs were clamped tight around his middle, her arms roped around his back, pulling him in, and he could not stop himself. He spilled himself inside. Pete rolled off his wife. Carla turned away from him, something she had never done in the past. She had always liked to cuddle. From her side, he heard her say,
"You okay?"
She didn't care what the answer was, Pete told himself. But he said, "Yeah, I'm fine." Even though he wasn't, there was something wrong with them, with their marriage. Not knowing was starting to kill him. Carla was beautiful. From the day that he had first seen her across the bar more than 3 years ago, he knew he wanted her for himself. Her skin was radiant, flawless golden brown. Her eyes dark, mesmerizing. Her lips full, pink, and pouty. She was shapely with large breasts and curvaceous hips, standing 5'3", exactly the height Pete liked his women. Her hair was thick, shiny, healthy, and black. Her eyebrows perfectly arched. But Pete was scared. He had spoken to her that night, tried his best to convince her to date him, and she did, but not for long. She had lost interest in him, and Pete managed to lose the woman that he knew he could have spent his life with to another man, the one man Pete thought would never threaten his happiness. But he had gotten her back. He wasn't proud of how, but he had, and now he felt that he might be losing her again, and he didn't know why. The days and nights passed, but they weren't much better. With each one, Carla spoke a little less to him, became a little more distant, sat a little farther from him on the sofa when they watched television. Pete broached the conversation so many times that Carla told him she was sick of talking about it.
"I told you,"
she said, becoming annoyed one night as she pulled the corner of the blanket back and was about to climb into bed.
"Can't things be bad for me at work? Can't I have hard days sometimes when I just don't feel like coming home and talking?"
"Yes, but it's been more than a month.
Can't I expect my wife to treat me like her husband and not a fucking stranger?"
Pete said, letting his anger get the better of him. Carla let the blanket fall from her hand, stepped away from the bed and toward the door.
"Where are you going?"
Pete said, sitting up in bed.
"I'll sleep in the guest bedroom tonight. Please don't try to convince me not to."
From that night on, Pete tried to give his wife the space she seemed to need, to allow her to have a few more bad days. But those few days turned into 2 weeks, then to months. And now Pete was standing angrily in front of the cold dinner he had just dumped into the trash. Pete went to his bedroom closet, changed his shirt, combed his hair, checked his billfold to see how much money he had, and found himself at the bar of the W Hotel. There, the main room contained a sea of beautiful, scantily dressed people. The music played loud around him as Pete sat in front of his third scotch and soda, trying not to meet the eyes of a woman who seemed intent on getting his attention. He told himself she was not looking at him, because the woman was striking, chocolate with piercing eyes, almost as beautiful as his wife, but not quite. And Pete was, well, fairly ordinary looking, with a broad nose, straight teeth, and a smile that improved his overall appearance when he chose to show it. But that was basically it. He was 6'3", in good shape, for he ran 5 miles daily and got to the gym a few times a week. But with his plain Crayola brown skin and just above average looks, women weren't in the habit of trampling over people to get to him. It wasn't the norm for gorgeous women to look his way, laugh, smile, and wave at him, as the woman across the bar just had. But it was attention, something that he had been lacking for what seemed so damn long. It felt good. Good enough, he thought, to risk making a fool of himself, to try a come-on line or two. So Pete downed the last of his drink, pulled himself from his seat, and walked over to the woman. He stood before her, not knowing what to say. But he didn't have to think long, for she spoke first.
You want to have a seat, or should I come with you?
Pete thought of all of the reasons why he shouldn't do what he was about to. But he also thought of how much he had been recently hurt, how Carla seemed not to care about him anymore. So as the woman that Pete had met at the bar only an hour ago reached down between his legs, stroked him, pulled him forward, he knew this was his last chance to make the so-called right decision. Pete suddenly realized that the reason this woman had smiled at him was that she recognized him from his practice. She had sprained her ankle 3 months ago, and he had examined her, wrapped her foot, given her a prescription for painkillers, and sent her on her way. He also remembered that she had been quite flirtatious during the visit, but things were just fine with him and Carla then, and he would never have considered returning her advances. But now, as they lay in the hotel bed that Pete had paid for, as he suspended his naked body over hers, the woman trying to guide Pete into her, he knew he was wrong. But he needed this, he thought, as he gave in. He had needed it for weeks now, wanted it from his wife, but she would not give it to him, so he had to come here. As Pete lowered himself and felt the tip of himself slide easily within the warm, wet crease of the woman, he looked down at her. It was Carla he saw for a moment. Then it became the woman again. And Pete let all his weight drop upon her, buried his face in the pillow beside her head, held her tight, slowly pushed into her. An hour later, Pete jumped up from the bed and stumbled into the bathroom, groped blindly for the switch on the wall, clicked it on, and stood in front of the sink, breathing hard, staring at himself in the mirror. His brown skin was covered with sweat. His lean, muscled torso glistened with it. What the hell had he just done? He yelled at himself as he turned on both water spigots full blast. Water streamed hard into the sink, and Pete yanked a hand towel from the rack, soaked it into the water. He grabbed the bar of soap, vigorously rubbed it into his crotch hair, then scrubbed the area with the wet washcloth. Fuck, 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 he said to himself, looking over his shoulder back into the bedroom. The bed sheets and blanket were strewn over the floor. The woman lay sprawled out across the bed, her arms and legs stretched out toward the four corners. She slept hard, snoring. He had screwed her into a sound slumber. Pete threw the damp rag to the floor, snatched a bath towel from another rack, and blotted the area between his legs dry. He pushed his nose into the towel, testing it for the woman's scent. He should have jumped in the shower, but it was already after 11 p.m. He needed to get home. He needed to get back to his wife. Pete plucked his clothes from the bedroom carpet, slid on his slacks, stepped into his shoes. He opened the door, looked back at the woman. He thought of waking her, maybe jotting a farewell on the back of a carryout menu, leaving it for her. He didn't. He closed the door and buttoned his shirt while running toward the elevator. When he jumped into his car, he picked up his cell phone from the leather passenger seat. There should have been 20 messages from Carla, but when he checked, there wasn't a single missed call. He punched in the code for his voicemail. Maybe the messages just hadn't registered. There was nothing in his mailbox either. As Pete slid his key into the ignition, his shirt still mostly unbuttoned, his tie slung around his neck like a scarf, he told himself that maybe his wife really didn't care about him anymore. When he pulled up in front of the 70-year-old house he had bought for himself and Carla as a wedding gift, he saw that all the lights were out, save for the single lamp that burned every night in the front window. He imagined Carla was sleeping peacefully without a care about where he was, what he was doing, or what he had done, for that matter. And look at him, he thought. Not half an hour ago, he had been racked with guilt for the sin he had committed. Pete stepped out of the car, slammed the door hard, like it was noon, and not almost midnight. He walked into the huge house, across the hardwood floor of the living room, and navigated his way up the stairs to the second floor. The bedroom door was pushed partially closed. Pete stepped in. He stood over the bed, over his wife sleeping peacefully. He could hear her faint breathing sounds. She had stopped waiting up for him a little less than 2 months ago, but the least she could have done was woken up when he walked in. For all she knew, he could have been an intruder standing over her with a razor-sharp knife and bad intentions. Everything was obviously just fine in Carla's little world. Pete stripped off his clothes, let them fall in a pile at his feet. He could still smell the faint scent of the sex he had with the woman wafting up from his groin. But now it didn't matter. If his wife no longer cared about what was going on with them, then neither did he. Chapter 3. His bedroom was dark as Wayne Mason lay in bed, staring blindly up at the ceiling. He thought about Carla, about the man that she had left him for, probably in bed making love to him at that very moment. Pete was like a brother to Wayne. No, he was Wayne's brother, had been since they were 10 years old. Pete had lived around the corner and down the block. They were in the same fourth grade class. On the days that Pete said he forgot his lunch, Wayne shared his. And when it kept happening, when Wayne thought that maybe Pete wasn't forgetting his lunch, but didn't have a lunch to bring, Wayne started bringing two. They would sit together, Wayne telling Pete how he always wanted a brother. Pete would tell Wayne the same thing.
Then let's do it.
Do what?
Pete said.
Be brothers.
How?
I don't know. I guess if we just say that we are, then we are. Okay?
Wayne said.
Okay.
Pete said, smiling, seeming not to realize how simple it was. From that day on, they were officially brothers. And when Wayne didn't see Pete in school for days at a time, he would walk over to his house to check on him. And when Pete asked Wayne if he could stay with him after school, because he didn't know when his mother would be back home, Wayne would stay with him as long as he could. Then there was the day after school when they sat in Pete's rundown house on his mother's secondhand sofa, watching the black and white TV.
Why doesn't your mother buy any food?
Wayne asked after they had both checked the kitchen cabinets and found them bare.
She says she's going to when she gets back.
When's she gonna get back?
Wayne asked.
I don't know. How long's she been gone?
Pete turned to Wayne and said,
Only 2 days this time.
2 days later, Wayne could remember standing just outside Wayne's father's house, Pete beside him, his head down, his face and clothes dirty. When Wayne's father opened the door, Wayne took Pete's hand and said,
Pete's mother been gone for 4 days, and we don't think she's coming back.
Come on in, Pete, Wayne's father said.
He was a doctor, clean-shaven, graying just a bit about the temples, and always smiling. Wayne watched as his father wrapped his arm around Pete's shoulder and ushered him into the house.
Don't you worry. We're going to find your mother, and everything's going to be just fine.
The three of them went back to Pete's house, got him enough clothes and whatever else he needed for the next week. Pete went to school from Wayne's house, ate all his meals there, and was treated as though he was one of the family. Wayne's mother and father called him son and asked him to do all the same things they would ask their own son, Wayne, to do, as if there was no difference between the two of them. Wayne's father had gone to the police. They said they would do all they could to find Pete's mother and tell him any news they found out. After Pete had been at the house for 2 weeks, Wayne's father stepped into Wayne's bedroom.
Can I borrow Pete for a minute? He asked.
Wayne watched as Pete rose from his bed, uncertainty on his face, then stepped out of the room. Wayne ran to the door to watch his father lead Pete down the hallway to his home study. Wayne imagined his father helping Pete into a chair, then his father sitting before him. That night, after Pete came back to the room, he told Wayne that his father had pulled a letter from his pocket, opened it up, and put his glasses on. The letter was from Pete's mother, letting him know that she could not handle raising him anymore. She had been battling a drug problem for so long, and it had taken what little money she made, and all of her ability to properly care for him. She wrote that she was sorry, would always love him, and would understand if he could never forgive her. Wayne's father looked up from the letter and put his hand on Pete's shoulder, a smile again on his face.
Your mother is entrusting me with you, son. Do you think you'd like to stay here and live with us?
Pete told Wayne that his father had said. Pete nodded, smiled as though he was happy. He was 10 years old then. But that night, Wayne heard Pete, lying in the twin bed beside him, crying like he was two.
Damn,
Wayne had said to Pete 2 years ago when they were both 35.
I think I'm going to sleep with Eva.
She was the girl that Wayne had been trying to date all during the years Pete and Wayne were in medical school together, before they met Carla. At the time, Eva had always told Wayne that if she had not already been engaged, maybe it would have been him she'd be engaged to, or at least they could have had a wonderful sexual relationship. She continued to smile and flirt with Wayne until graduation, when they both had gone their separate ways. But then, later, after Wayne was about to get married to Carla, he ran into Eva at a restaurant. She told him she was no longer engaged and was very interested in seeing what she had missed in medical school with him.
I gotta do it, Wayne said excited.
They were at Pete's Northside condo. Pete was lacing up his basketball shoes.
Did you tell Eva that you were engaged? Pete said. Yeah, that's what's so cool. She just wants to have sex one time. She doesn't care that I'm engaged. Then I guess that makes two of you. And I guess you already got permission from Carla.
Who?
Wayne said, joking.
Your fiance. I know this sounds like the most ridiculous thing in the world, Wayne said, spinning the basketball in his hands. But I don't think I'm going to tell her.
Pete stood, looked Wayne right in the face.
If you want to fuck around, Why marry Carla? Because I love her. Because I want to spend the rest of my life with her.
But, Pete said,
all right. You want to hear that I'm scared? Then I'm scared. Or maybe I just feel like this will be my last hurrah. You know? Men do it all the time at their bachelor parties. I'm not even having a bachelor party, so I'll just do it now.
And if she finds out, Pete said,
that's not going to happen. You and I are the only ones who will know about this. She won't find out.
This is wrong. Carla's cool. She loves you, Pete said. I really think you need to consider what you stand to lose.
Pete, Wayne said, resting a hand on his friend's shoulder, this is one of those moments that every person has when consideration is the last thing they should give because they know what they're about to do makes no sense at all. Just support me on this. Or at the very least, say that you can halfway understand why I'm doing it.
Pete shook his head. Sorry, man. I can't do it. Wayne slept with her. And for what it was worth, he would have enjoyed himself more with a porno flick and a handful of Vaseline. Afterward, he stripped off the rubber, smiled at Eva, kissed her on the cheek, and said,
at least now we know what we missed.
Before he went home, Wayne stopped off at Pete's place.
So, Pete said, did you come to your senses or did you behave like the typical man, be a dog and fuck her? I fucked her. It wasn't worth the time it took me to drive over there. But it's over, Wayne said, smiling.
You seem particularly happy about that. You don't think you made the wrong decision?
I don't necessarily think it was the right one, but it's done now. I still have Carla, who I love, who I'm going to marry, and never cheat on once that's done. So everything is everything. No harm, no foul, right?
Right, Pete said. Later that evening, it was strange, but when Wayne saw Carla, he felt that sleeping with Eva only made him realize just how much he loved the woman that he was engaged to. Maybe it was the comparison that let him know how much more he had than what he had just been with. Or maybe it allowed him to remember what it was like to have sex with a woman that he cared nothing for versus actually making love to a woman. Whatever the reason, that night, Wayne could not stop professing his love and happiness for Carla.
You're acting weird, Carla said.
If telling you how much I love you and actually meaning it means that I'm weird, Wayne said, holding Carla tight and kissing her on the cheek, then I'm the weirdest man alive.
When Wayne made love to Carla that night, he kept his eyes open the entire time, for he wanted to see the pleasure he gave her. When they finally fell asleep, he held her tight to him, knowing that the rest of his life was there within his arms. The next day, Wayne could not remove the smile from his face. Everything seemed wonderful. He had plans with Carla later to do dinner and go see one of his favorite blues singers. It was odd when after 6 p.m., he had not spoken to her all day. He had tried calling her from work once in the morning just to say hey like he normally did. And then he called again around lunchtime, which was the ritual. He had left messages both times, but his calls had not been returned. After Wayne got off work, he had called her 3 more times on both her cell and home phones and still got no answer. He had driven by her apartment, knocked on her door, but she was not there. As he walked back toward the street, he glanced at his watch. It was 10 minutes till 7, and their dinner reservations were for 7:30. Something was definitely wrong, and he really started to worry. After climbing into his car, he dialed Pete's number.
What's going on? Pete answered. I'm worried, man. I've been calling Carla all day, and she hasn't called me back. We were supposed to do dinner tonight. This isn't like her.
There was silence for a long moment on Pete's end. So long that Wayne said,
You there?
We need to talk.
What do you mean, we need to talk?
Meet me at the old Red Dog bar, Pete said. I'm right near there.
Pete, what's going on?
Wayne said, more worried than before.
Just meet me there. I'll tell you.
Wayne hurried toward the bar. Pete was there, hunched over an empty mug of beer, looking melancholy.
What's going on? Wayne said, running up to him. Why do you have me meeting you here?
Carla is all right, Pete said.
How the hell do you know that?
Because I was with her today.
You were with her?
Wayne said, confused but starting to anger. I met her after work, and then we went back to her place.
To fucking do what, Pete?
Wayne said, grabbing his best friend tight by his jean jacket.
So I could tell her what you did. So I could tell her that you slept with Eva.
The words were like a punch, like an actual physical assault that had Wayne stumbling back, throwing his hands to his face. He bent over, Carla's face in his mind. Wayne seeing, knowing how painful that news must have been. After all he had said to her last night, after the love they made, the promises he guaranteed, and then the following day to hear that it was all lies, and from Wayne's best friend, no less. Wayne stood, slowly pulled his hands from his face, glared at Pete with all the anger within him and said,
Why? Why the fuck did you do it?
Because she deserved better, Wayne. She deserves better. I told you not to do it. Wayne snatched Pete by his collar, reared back, punched him hard across the jaw, knocking Pete from the bar stool onto the floor. He fell on his side, scurried to protect his stomach when Wayne rushed up on him, about to kick him. Wayne held the blow, a tear sliding from his eye as he looked down at Pete.
I'm sorry things had to turn out this way, Pete said, holding his jaw, wincing in pain.
Wayne looked down at him pathetically, shook his head, then ran out. That was 2 years ago, and now, as Wayne lay in bed, he could not shake the thought of Carla from his mind. Her telling him that he could no longer see her hurt him more than he ever imagined it would. But Wayne had to ask himself if that was because he was just trying to win Carla back, because of how Pete had stolen her from him, or did he still have feelings for the woman? None of that mattered. Carla had made her decision. Wayne shifted his weight in bed a little, a question coming to his mind. What would he do now? Carla said her marriage was beginning to suffer because she was seeing Wayne. That was the last thing he wanted to happen. Yes, he knew that if Carla did decide to leave Pete and come back to him, it would mean the destruction of his brother's marriage. But that would be because Carla alone made the decision. Wayne told himself he would not try to persuade her or force her hand in any manner. She would make her decision on her own, and last night, she had done just that. Wayne had to respect that decision, he thought sadly. He would have to forget her and move on. Wayne turned a little in bed, then made an effort to still himself, but it was too late. An arm was thrown over his bare chest, and a beautiful mocha-skinned woman with thick, curly black hair placed her face in the crook of his neck and kissed him on the jaw.
I love you,
Michelle said, her voice groggy. It took him a moment to dump all that he had been thinking out of his head, and then Wayne finally said, wrapping an arm around her, pulling her closer, kissing her forehead.
I love you too.
Chapter 4. When Carla returned home around 10 p.m., after leaving Wayne, she expected to see her husband the moment she had walked in the door. Pete sitting in the living room, the TV off, his legs crossed, just waiting. But to Carla's relief, he wasn't there. She walked into the house feeling numb, as though what she had just done to Wayne wasn't real. She had managed to keep herself from crying too hard on the way home. She didn't want Pete to see her that way when she stepped into the house. She was hungry, but as she walked into the kitchen, she knew she couldn't eat, wouldn't be able to keep the food down. When she felt for the light and clicked it on, she saw the pile of dirty pots and pans, dishes and glasses stacked in the sink, and the discarded meal in the trash. She had forgotten. Pete had promised to make dinner tonight. Another attempt at fixing things between them after he had been so upset the night before. How wrong she had been to him, Carla thought later while pulling on her nightgown. For so long he had tried to remedy a situation he had no idea how to fix. In typical Pete fashion, he assumed everything was his fault, and Carla had let him go on thinking that. Pete's attempts to fix things would give her more time to decide just what she wanted to do with Wayne, she thought then. But as she lay down in bed and pulled the covers up to her chest, she knew she had been wrong. That was the reason Pete had trashed the dinner, why he was probably out that very moment, because he was just fed up, she thought. But she would make it up to him, she told herself. At 11, Carla clicked off her bedside lamp, but she wasn't able to sleep. Sometime near 12, she heard Pete's car door slam. She heard him come in, make his way up the stairs, and walk into the bedroom. She lay on her side, facing the windows, pretending to be asleep. She didn't exactly know why. Maybe because she felt so guilty, felt that if she even said a word to him, a torrent of incomprehensible gobble would spill from her mouth, and in that mess would come her confession. Carla didn't need that. Not at that moment. So as she heard her husband disrobing, she told herself that in the morning she would discuss the situation with him, work on making things better. When the morning came, Pete was not there. After putting on her robe, walking through the house, checking the garage for his car, Carla realized that he had left. It wasn't even 7 yet, a full hour and a half before he normally left for work. But he was gone. An hour later, after driving to the building that housed the magazine where she worked, Carla walked through the parking garage and climbed onto an elevator peopled with attractive-looking employees of some of the other businesses in the building. She spoke to no one. Her mind was on Pete and still on Wayne. Last night at the restaurant, he'd said he had made a mistake a year and a half ago and asked her if she could just get past it. If he had only known the pain she felt that day after she answered the door and found Pete standing there, looking as though he needed to confess some horrible crime. She could tell there was something terribly wrong just by the look on his face, the sweat on his brow. "Come in," she said. She walked him over to her sofa, where she had been looking at seating arrangements for her wedding reception. "Is everything all right?" Carla asked him, worried. Pete looked down at the papers on the table, picked up one of the seating charts, but did not answer her. Carla grabbed the sheet, set it back on the table. "Pete, why are you here? Is everything okay?" At first, Pete didn't respond. Then finally said, "How much do you love Wayne?" "I'm about to marry him. I love him a lot. Why are you asking me that?" Carla said with increasing anxiety. Pete shifted on the sofa, turned to face her. I don't know how to tell you this.
Just tell me, Pete,
Carla said, her voice rising. Wayne, he slept with another woman. The elevator opened on the floor of the Verge magazine office, and Carla snapped back to the present, putting Wayne out of her mind. Verge wasn't only a fashion magazine, nor a social, celebrity-driven, or women's magazine, but all of the above. She walked across purple carpeting past glass-top workstations where writers, fashion editors, graphic designers, and other support staff tapped away on keyboards and glared at flat-screen computer monitors. The ceilings were high, the walls were lime green and pink, and a fusion of neo-soul and jazz music played softly from tiny hidden speakers. Carla's office was at the back of the huge open area where all the magazine's employees worked. When she got to Lacey's office, she stopped just at the door and stuck her head in.
Need to talk to you, Carla said, then continued on to her office.
Once inside, she walked through the huge space with its back wall of floor-to-ceiling windows looking out over Chicago's Grant Park. She slid open one of the drawers of her glass-top desk, dropped in her purse, then leaned back in her executive chair, crossed her legs, and covered her face with her hands. Carla's attention was drawn to the door when Lacey knocked lightly on the frame, then entered, closing the door behind her. Lacey and Carla had worked together at the magazine for more than 5 years. In that time, she and Carla had become best friends, even though at 29, Lacey was 6 years younger. Lacey sat in one of the two green leather chairs in front of Carla's desk. The younger woman was attractive, brown-skinned, and always very well manicured. Her hair was cut short, shiny black, straightened, and parted on one side. She wore narrow-framed glasses on the tip of her pierced nose, which made her look studious, and she always wore slacks that clung just a little tighter than Carla thought appropriate for the office setting. But Lacey was Carla's girl.
You feeling all right?
Lacey said.
I did it. I told Wayne I couldn't see him anymore,
Carla said, standing up from her chair and turning to look out the windows.
Is that what you wanted? I thought you said you were trying to decide if...
That's the thing, Carla said, turning back and cutting Lacey off.
Decide what? I have no right to decide anything. I'm married, and whether or not I still feel I may love Wayne or move too fast in marrying Pete, that doesn't discount the fact that I did.
Carla sat back into her chair.
I took those vows, and I need to stay true to them.
And that's it? Lacey said.
That's it. I imagine Wayne took it hard,
Lacey said.
Probably not harder than me,
Carla said, lowering her face into her hands again. She heard her friend rise from her chair, felt Lacey's hand on her head, smoothing her hair.
Don't worry about it. That part of your life is over. Now you can concentrate on you and Pete. You know that man really loves you, don't you?
Carla looked up.
I know he did, but I don't know about that anymore. I've been spending so much time trying to decide what I was going to do with the man I had that I may have messed up things with the man I'm with.
So what are you going to do?
I have to do my best to fix it.
Chapter 5. When Wayne rolled over in bed that morning, he thought that he might have had a very bad dream. That was until he took a moment, lay there, and remembered what had happened the night before. Sleep was awful for him, tossing and turning, knowing that the chance for him and Carla ever being together again had passed. Some hours ago, he was gently awoken by Michelle. As he slowly opened his eyes, her beautiful brown face came into focus.
You're going to be late for work, she said softly.
I'll run your shower water. Come down after and I'll make you some breakfast.
Don't worry about it,
Wayne said, his voice raspy from sleep.
I got up, called in, and canceled my appointments.
You sure?
Yeah. But thanks,
Wayne said, raising up in bed to give Michelle a kiss. He rolled onto his stomach, pulled a pillow over his head, and tried to stop the painful news Carla had given him from entering his dreams again. When Wayne woke for the second time, he glanced at his alarm clock. It was 10 minutes to 10. He pulled himself up to a sitting position and remained in bed, bare-chested for a moment, deciding what he should do. Carla had always been the first thing Wayne thought of upon waking, but now things were different. He had to admit, regardless of how strongly he felt about getting Carla back, what he was doing to Michelle was wrong. And although she had known what he had been doing over the past 2 months, he had warned her. He had met Michelle 6 months ago. It had been almost that long since Carla left him. And although Wayne still felt as though he was not over her and wasn't willing to entertain another relationship, he noticed when he bumped into Michelle standing in line at Starbucks. He felt an attraction for her, which surprised him. She was beautiful. Rich, smooth skin, big, vivid black eyes, a button nose, and full, kissable lips. Her spring dress clung nicely to her hips and exposed her shapely legs. He stared down at the fine curls on the back of her neck, feeling the urge to brush them aside, kiss her there. She walked past Wayne, sat down at a corner table, glanced at a newspaper. He pulled money out of his pocket to pay for his coffee and a muffin. He glanced over his shoulder at her, took his change. Standing at the door, ready to leave, he eyed her again. His intention was to just go, thinking of Carla. But he asked himself, was she still thinking of him? No. She had just gotten married. He was there to witness that, up close, as Pete's best man. It had killed him, but now it was time to move on. Wayne found himself standing over the woman's table, coffee and small white bag in his hand. She looked up at him, seeming intrigued.
My name is Wayne, he said. Would you like to share my muffin?
The woman looked at him oddly.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.